Now, here we have the famous Brachiosaurus. And as you can see, it's got this enormous long neck and this head up here, a massive body, pillar-like legs, and this long tail like here. So what we want to do is to try and bring one of these ancient animals in some sense alive. And that, if you went back 100 million years, would is what you'd see. You must imagine yourself walking across a forested area, coming into open ground, and suddenly you'd see these enormous things going up, looking like almost huge snakes. They would be as high as that. They're astonishing. But we want to still bring it alive. And there are some particular problems which we, the paleontologists, can investigate. Now, that head up there is practically out of sight, but what I have here is another head of a dinosaur. And if I rotate this around, then we can make two important points. On this side of the model, the skin has been stripped away, and of course we have the skull visible, and within the skull there is brain tissue, and that requires a great deal of blood, as do our brains. In addition, there is a series of complicated muscles in here, which are used mostly to power the jaw, because up there, as high as a three-story building, this animal is seizing great lumps of foliage and swallowing them as fast as possible. It's got an enormous appetite. And so what we have to understand is that those muscles also require a constant supply of blood. So what is necessary now is if I can ask Ilya to remove the outer neck so that we can see the internal plumbing of this brachiosaur. Connecting the top of the head, the brain, and the muscles, there would be enormous arteries, colossal great pipes of material. And those, of course, would be connected to the heart. And we now have to demonstrate just what the problems might be with the pumping up of blood to such an enormous height. Now, at this stage, I wonder if I could ask for a volunteer. Maybe the boy third along with the sort of yellowish T-shirt here. Would you like to come down? Welcome. And can you first of all tell me your name?
James.
You're James. Excellent. Now, James, what I'd like you to do to start with, please, is we must imagine that this is the brachiosaur heart. It didn't look like this on the outside, but the brachiosaur heart, the name of this dinosaur, operated in effectively the same sort of fashion. So if you'd like to take this handle, and I'd ask you to only use one hand, please. Can you start to pump up and down? It's already primed, I trust. There we go. And I'll tell you when to stop. There we go. And now we see the blood surging upwards. Carry on, James. You're doing excellently. That's good. Okay, excellent. Carry on. How are you doing? Okay, what's your sort of sensation? Is it getting easier or more difficult?
More difficult.
It's getting much more difficult. And we'll just give it, I think, maybe one more. Okay, let's stop. Stop. That's excellent. Okay. Now, if you just, we can let go of the pump now. Thank you. The reason, of course, it's becoming much more difficult is because you're, it's heavier. That's right. You're pushing up against gravity. You're trying to push the thing up as high as possible. So that gives you the sense of how muscular that heart must have been. Probably the heart itself would have been about this big, a colossal structure. But there is a second problem, and I'll ask James in a moment just to do one final operation. And that is to do with the fact that, of course, this dinosaur, like other vertebrates, has a pair of lungs. But the lungs are thin, delicate tissue. Why are they that? Because they have to be thin enough to allow the oxygen, which flows through the nose, of course, into the lungs, to diffuse through that area. Now, if you think about it for a moment, James, if you've used all that pressure to push the blood up to the top of the head, then the blood is under enormous pressure. And so, in a sense, the pressure now stored up there what would happen if it flowed directly to the lungs, and I think James will be able to show us, because what I'd ask you to now do is just move that lever smartly over that direction. Wonderful. Oops, right. And we'll just see what's going to happen, because now, of course, the lungs are under threat. What's happening here is that we have this huge heart pumping away like this, and we have these thin, delicate membranes which have to take in the oxygen. Are they? Oh, dear. Ghastly, ghastly. Quite unpleasant. Okay. You should not laugh. Can I thank you very much indeed? Many thanks. Thank you. What happens to the head, so high in the sky, what has happened to the lungs, means that we have to think of the heart of this dinosaur as being much more sophisticated than the hearts we find in living reptiles. The heart, surely, never mind how big it was very similar to our hearts, which are effectively two pumps stuck together. There's a powerful pump to send the blood around the body. There's a weaker pump to send the blood round the lungs and not danger the rupturing, which we've just seen there.